Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, from whom all good proceeds, grant that by your inspiration we may think those things that are right, and by your merciful guiding may do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Genesis. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." The word of the Lord.
If you, Lord, were to go to
A reading from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. Just as we have the same spirit of faith that is in accordance with Scripture, I believed, so I spoke. We also believe, and so we speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look not at what can be seen, but what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
During the singing of our sequence hymn, children are invited to follow the cross to Children's Church.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
The crowd came together again so that Jesus and his disciples could not even eat. When his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, "He has gone out of his mind." And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, "He has Beelzebul, and by the ruler of the demons, he casts out demons." And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed, the house can be plundered. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they had said, "He has an unclean spirit." Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, "Your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you." And he replied, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And looking at those who sat around him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. O God, from whom all good proceeds, grant that by your inspiration we may think those things that are right, and by your merciful guiding may do them. At first hearing, the words from this morning's collect seem to pretty much sum up our Christian life, don't they? God, please just tell me what you want me to do and help me do it. That's simple enough, right? So why then have we been praying this exact same prayer in our church every year since Thomas Cranmer's first Book of Common Prayer in 1549? By now, haven't we figured out what it is that God might want us to do? Have we as humans not evolved somehow so that we know what is right and what is wrong simply by instinct? Well, unfortunately, looking around our world today, I think that answer is pretty clear. Too often do we see and hear stories of people who acted with their own interests at stake, frequently to the disadvantage of another human being. Why do we not automatically default to doing good, even when it means that we might be inconvenienced or put out somehow? Just as professional athletes practice the same move over and over again until they build their muscle memory, perhaps we are actually called to do the same thing, but only on a spiritual and ethical level. As y'all know, before I entered seminary, I was in the Navy, and even though the Naval Academy provided the foundation for that military career, there was no amount of theoretical exercise or study of regulations that could have prepared me for my first experience with the real Navy, the fleet. I had just completed my second year and was halfway through my training at the academy. The drudgeries of that first plebe year were far behind me, and I was looking forward to my junior year and enjoying the greatest privilege of all, having a car. So needless to say, I was feeling pretty good with myself and was very excited about my first summer training aboard a real-life Navy ship. Now, in my mind's eye, I had visions of sailing the South Pacific to exotic ports of call, or slicing through the open ocean on a sleek, massive battleship. Never mind that we haven't had battleships for a while. But my slightly romanticized and delusional summer plans were made up. Russell Crowe and I would be on that sailing ship together, both in our three-corner hats, just like in Master and Commander. I was pumped. And then my orders came in. Did we even have a base in New Jersey? The mighty oiler, USS Detroit, was stationed in Earl, New Jersey. It was at the end of a 3-mile-long pier, presumably so that if this ship filled with ammunition and fuel were to, say, explode, that it wouldn't destroy the city as well. As our white 15-passenger government van approached the ship, my classmates and I looked in shock and horror as we saw that our home for the next 6 weeks was in a state of utter disrepair. It turned out that the mighty Detroit was having a mighty overhaul and was not going to leave the pier for our entire cruise period. So after settling into our berthing, I went to find the division officer that I was supposed to be shadowing for the summer. Looked for him all afternoon, couldn't find him. It wasn't until about midnight when I saw him trudge up the gangplank, followed at some distance by this young, forlorn sailor. And as the sailor sulked by us and went inside, I introduced myself to the officer, who wasn't much older than I was. And it turns out that he had just come back from the local jail. The young sailor was in his division and had been arrested earlier for disorderly conduct because apparently the state of New Jersey frowns upon those who run around their malls in a gorilla costume. What had I gotten myself into? Spending a day at the jail bailing out your sailor who was arrested in a gorilla outfit was not in the admission brochures of the Naval Academy. There were no classes that covered this scenario. But somehow the qualities of leadership and putting someone else's well-being before your own actually were deeply ingrained throughout that entire formation process. So whether or not that young officer knew exactly how to get his sailor out of jail was actually inconsequential. He simply knew it was the right thing to do, and he would figure it out along the way. The transition from military into seminary was actually pretty fascinating because of the similarities between how each one treats the training and the formation of their career professionals. In a residential seminary, there was little separation between school, church, and family time. One became immersed in the routine of morning prayer, evening prayer, and daily Eucharist. Classes were built around this schedule, and even the wider community of spouses and children became involved in these activities. We were effectively learning, sleeping, and eating church from the moment that we left the house in the morning until we returned in the evening. We learned from our professors, most of whom were ordained priests, but most importantly, we learned from each other. Now, there were 24 people in my class at Swanee, and when you bring that many people together and put them on the top of a mountain in the middle of nowhere, there's little choice but to learn everything about everyone. Questions of faith, doctrine, and even one's calling to the priesthood were common discussions. And it was that common struggle that really can't be replicated anywhere else. And then finally, after those 3 years, when we graduated with our Masters of Divinity, we were all placed in a church, the real church. And I'll be the first to tell you, hasn't been a parishioner in a gorilla costume yet, but there have been many, many times when all of the seminary classes and training I received has had no bearing whatsoever on a situation that I was presented with. But those are the times that that spiritual and mental formation has really paid off. Information really is not limited to the ordained or even to massive bureaucratic institutions like the military or even the Episcopal Church. We're all being formed every day by everything around us, both good and bad. We prayed for God to inspire us that we may think those things that are right. But how do we expect God to be able to get a word in if we're constantly surrounded by the unceasing noise and distraction of society today? Without some sort of foundation for God to build upon, how is God supposed to form us and ultimately use us to change the world? I believe the first step in building this foundation can actually be the hardest. And that's for us to simply let go of that control and allow some room for God to enter into our lives. Now, I'm not talking about doing something drastic like going to live in a cave in a desert somewhere. There are actually two pretty simple things that I've picked up along the way that have really changed the way I perceive God in my life, and I invite you to try one or both for yourself. First, read the Bible, just a little, each day. You can use the daily office readings, and there are plenty of websites that do all that hard work for you. Learning the context of the passages we hear each Sunday really puts things into perspective. Secondly, pray. Try to carve out a little time each day that's reserved for prayer. Pray with your family. Pray with your children or your grandchildren before they go to bed. Let them know it's okay to talk about God and Jesus. It won't only impact your own spiritual life, but begin to form theirs as well. What a gift. Through our baptisms, we are called by Christ to all be ministers. In fact, all of you, the laity, are the royal priesthood. Few are called to the ordained ministry. The majority of us are not. If we, as the Episcopal Church, left it solely up to clergy to spread the life-giving message of the gospel, we would reach a whopping 0.9% of all Americans. We'd be preaching to only those who had already decided to come to church on a Sunday morning and who, like you, presumably already have some desire to form a relationship with God. But what about that other 99.1%? That's where you, as the church, comes in. Imagine the impact you can have in the community when they see you making choices and decisions that don't always benefit you personally. Imagine the impact you can have if someone who is struggling with her faith sees you asking a blessing before you eat dinner at some nice restaurant. And just with any type of formation, as uncomfortable as these actions might be at first, they will continue to form your spiritual lives and will ultimately make room for God to work through you. Jesus says, "Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother." I invite you this morning to open yourself to be changed. Give God that opportunity to speak to you. Listen to what God might actually be saying to you. And then allow yourself to follow that voice. Children of God, sisters and brothers in Christ, be who you are. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the Church and for the world.
Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
This morning we pray for Will, Dennis, Mildred, Lynn, Henry, Elizabeth, Tony, Peter, Glenn, Walt, Phil, Marcy Ann, Susan, Helen, Julia, Carol, Gloria, Clement, and Beth. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hopes in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
This morning we remember Rebecca Kinzer. We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, very good morning to y'all, the brave crowd who trudged out in this weather. It's great to see you on this morning. If you're visiting, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. There's some cards that are in the pew racks you're welcome to fill out and drop in the plates if you want to know more about St. John's or what we do and how you can be part of that as well. So again, welcome, welcome. We're so glad you're here. As a reminder, the committal service for Frank Price will be this Tuesday coming up at 11 o'clock in the garden. There'll be a visitation in the library at 10:30 right before that. And then following the committal, there's gonna be a bench dedication in Delano Park. So everyone is invited to that and celebrate Frank's life among us. Also, it's exciting news, our Wednesday afternoon healing service is starting back.
Yay!
That'll be at 12:10 in the chapel here, Eucharist and prayers for healing. Every Wednesday, 12:10. So please come to that. Because of the rain, the formation in the park that was scheduled to be in the park is going to be in the parish hall this afternoon. So at 5:30, children's formation will be in the parish hall at 5:30. And finally, a couple notes about communion. Yes, communion wine is back today, Because of our diocesan guidance, there's some things just to know. Right now, the preferred method will be intinction, which is dipping your host into the wine. You'll notice that there's not going to be a whole lot of wine in the chalice, and that's on purpose. That's to make sure that people's fingers stay dry and that the host is the thing that gets the wine. So, also as a reminder that in the Episcopal Church, all are welcome, all baptized Christians are welcome to receive communion, and that we also believe that Jesus Christ is fully present in both the bread and the wine. So if for every reason you feel uncomfortable or don't choose to take the wine, that's perfectly fine. You can just cross your arms when the chalice comes and they'll pass you by. So that's a perfectly acceptable thing to do. And because it's the first Sunday of the month, we'll celebrate the birthdays that are happening in June. So if you're having a birthday or have had a birthday in June, I invite you to come on forward and we will offer a blessing for you. I know there's one behind me. Come on down. Good man.
Yeah.
All right. Let us pray. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may thy peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Happy birthday. Are there any anniversaries this month? None. Right. Walk in love as Christ loved us, gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself, in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. and now as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.